Have you ever had one of those weeks? You know what I'm talking about? Like one of those weeks where it just feels like chaotic and thing just gets added like one thing to another to another to another. It's like pile on weeks. You know, I think there's a kid's book about that. It's like the no good, terrible, horrible, very bad. Did you ever have one of those like turn into a week long thing? Right? Like for us, it wasn't necessarily like the no good, terrible, horrible, very bad day week, but it was just a crazy, chaotic week for us, for my family. It started out, my wife and I were trying to get our house on the market. We're just moving like a mile down the road from where we live now. And so we have all these projects that we're trying to finish, and it's just been go, 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 go. Like, do your schedule ever feel like that? Just like constant. So we said, this week we're going to pull back from all activities and we're going to take intentional break to be together as a family. And then we're going to like work on these projects so we'll get the house ready and all of that sort of stuff. And have you ever heard that phrase, we plan and God laughs, right? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, and so this week, like, it started out great, you know, and all this stuff, but then like just chaos collides. So both of my wife's sisters were pregnant together. And so they had their babies within 50 minutes of each other on the same day. And so we're like, get the call. You're never going to believe it. Like, your niece is here. You're never going to believe it. Your nephew is here. We're like, what? This is such an awesome day. And so, you know, we already have like a gaggle of kids anyway. So it's like, just add your kids to our kids. And then, like, we'll take the ones that you have, and that way you can be with the baby in the hospital and stuff. And it was awesome. So we get to go down and see our little niece, Kaylee. And then we get to go see our nephew, Elijah. You know, and we're just celebrating. This is an awesome day. And then we've got, like, more at our house spending the night. It's like sleepover. You know, that's always fun with lots of girls. And so anyway, we're, like, going through it. But then, like, this celebratory thing turns into, like, this really hard news too, and we're right before they're getting ready to release our niece to come home. They have these new tests that they just started within the last 5 years, and one of those tests on her heart showed that there was something wrong, and so they had to life flight her down to CMC and main campus at Levine's Children's Hospital. And there's all this uncertainty about what it is and what's going on and trying to figure out, and we're just praying and trusting the Lord, but the hard thing of saying, okay, well, I've got to leave my baby at this hospital while I go home because they're in the neonatal nursery and there's nowhere you can go and there's no place to sleep or no, you know, it's just like the hardship of that. And thankfully, praise God, like she's going to be able to have surgery early this week. And so we'd ask you to pray for that, but she's going to have surgery, and it's not the heart surgery that goes through your chest, which would have been a more extensive recovery, but they'll go through her side. And so it's like 1 week in the NICU versus 2 weeks recovery and all of that. And so the Lord has been so gracious, you know, and all that. But we're just kind of getting over that news. And then we get the phone call yesterday that Kitty's other sister has to go back into the hospital because she's got the flu and can't be around the baby. So we're just like, oh, my goodness. And it's like, oh, and by the way, we're remodeling the house. All right. And so I figure, what am I going to do? Like, for those of you who don't know me, I am not handy at all. And I decide, well, I can do these projects. Like, I've been touch-up painting. I've been doing all kinds of stuff, man. Like, I got this. And so we decide we're going to replace some tile in our bathroom that's cracked. And so there's, like, three tiles. I'm like, anybody can do this, right? This sounds easy. And I told my wife, I YouTube this. This sounds like the guy on YouTube makes it look so easy. And so I go in there. I got a chisel. You know, I'm, like, hammering out the ceramic tile. And I'm doing it just like the YouTube guy. And then all of a sudden, like, I'm pulling up the tile, you know. So it's, like, because it's releasing from the floor, so I pull it up and it cracks in my hand, and like this really sharp point like cuts my finger down almost to the bone, and so then I'm like holding my thing and I'm like streaming obscenities that I've since repented of, and then I'm like talking to my wife, and she's like, my favorite comment of the whole night, like in the midst of all this chaos of stuff that's going on with babies and sleepovers and nieces and nephew, all these other things, right? And my favorite comment was, well, you know, babe, if you end up having to go to the ER and get stitches, you probably are going to lose all the money you saved us by doing it yourself. I'm like, challenge accepted. Right? And so I'm like, I'm not going. I don't care. If my finger has to be like this my whole life, if it grows back together and it like won't ever bend, that's what am I? I'll just point at you weird and you'll laugh. It's fine. And so, but you know, it's one of those things, like that's all just after all. So if you do tile work, I need your help. But after all of that, right? Like, I mean, our week is good after all that, because I mean, God is good. And like, we're so grateful that these tests, like 5 years ago, if Kaylee would have been born, she would have gone home. And then it could have been catastrophic. They wouldn't have seen what was going on with her heart. And so, you know, we look at all these things, as hard as it is, or as chaotic, or as crazy, like, you're still, we're good. But there are moments in life where things don't feel good, right? Like where you just feel like you get sucker punched by the devil, right? And there are times in life where you suffer because you believe in Jesus. Like, there's times where people are persecuted because they believe in Jesus. And this is what was going on for the Hebrew believers. These are Jewish believers that have trusted in Jesus, and they were starting to suffer for their faith. I mean, it wasn't just like a little suffering. They were starting to really suffer, and they were starting to get their stuff taken away from them because they were believers in Jesus. They were starting to get thrown into prison. They were getting locked up because they believed in Jesus. And so some of them were facing such hardship and such persecution because they loved Jesus that they started to question, like, is this worth it? Like, is loving Jesus and all the things that are going to go along with it, like the trial, the hardship, the persecution, like all this stuff, like, is it really worth it to really love Jesus this way? And some of them were starting to think, hey, you know what? Like, that whole animal sacrifice wasn't so bad. If we had lots of feast days and fasts and all these things, like, you know, that was looking pretty good. And they're starting to question, should we go back to the way things used to be? And the author of Hebrews writes to them to say, no, Jesus is worth it. He's more than enough. And so I want us to look at what we can learn about encouragement through this lens of this author of Hebrews writing to these Hebrew Christians that are starting to go through the persecution and trials and hardships in life, and what that can teach us for when we go through trials and hardships. Look at what it says, Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear his voice, don't what? Don't harden your hearts as in the rebellion on the day of testing in the wilderness, where your fathers put me to the test, and they saw my works for how long? 40 years. Now here's the deal. Do you ever, like, if you're giving advice to people, do you ever quote song lyrics? Right? Like, this is what the author of Hebrews is doing. Like, I'll throw song lyrics in to my sermon sometimes, and you guys don't catch it half the time, and that's okay, but it's fine. But like, this is what the author of Hebrews is doing. He throws up Psalm 95, and all the good Jewish Christians would have known this psalm. And so this is actually a quotation where he says, hey, if you hear the voice of God today, don't harden your hearts like they did in the wilderness, where they tested me over and over and over again. They saw my works for 40 years. And so if you go back to the Psalm 95, it actually tells you the place of testing. And it's this place called Meribah. And do you know what that translates to? Strife. What would it be like to live in a town called Strife? Like, some of you live there now. It's a place called your home. All right, so, but anyway, right? It's called teenage years. All right, so, but here's what it is. So it's this place called Strife. And do you know what happened there? It's this old story. You can go back and look it up in the book of Exodus. I think it's Exodus like 17, and then in Numbers it retells it. But there's this story. So God's led the people of Israel out of Egypt, right? They were slaves in Egypt, been slaves for over 300 years. They're crying out, send us a deliverer, send us a deliverer. And so God sends Moses, right? So you know the whole thing, the plagues, right? And they're leaving, and by the end of it, Pharaoh says, like, go, get out of here and take our stuff with you. But then what happens? He changes his mind. So he sends the army out afterwards, and so Moses is there, and the people are cornered, and the presence of God is there with them. And so the Red Sea parts, and they go over on dry ground, right? You remember this? And so now they're wandering through, and they've gone to Mount Sinai, and they've gotten the law. They've gotten the Ten Commandments, and they're hungry. And so, like, they wake up every day, and they go out, and they get, like, flat Krispy Kremes on the ground. Like, every morning it's like this manna from heaven, these honey flavored little cake bread things, and so they go out and they gather, and like, we want meat, it's not enough, we have more than a sweet tooth. So then they go out at night, and God's like sent birds down. I mean, like, think of their existence out in the middle of the desert. There's nothing there, and they walk out every morning outside their tent, like, what do you want for breakfast today? I'm gonna have some manna. You gonna have some manna? I hear the manna's good. And so they like gather up the manna, and then they eat it, and then at night they go out and they're like, I think it's dinner time. Like, and then the bird's right there, and they just take it and then make it. Like, this is God's provision for them over and over. And everywhere they went, think about this, before they moved anywhere, the presence of God was continually with them. right? It was the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night, right? And so when they were supposed to move, the presence of God would take off, and it was like God's GPS. You just follow the cloud, right? And so they would go, and they would make their way. I mean, they've seen God's power, and they've seen God's provision, and they've seen God's protection. But do you know what? When times got hard, every single time, here's what they said. Well, are you even here or not, God? That's what they did. And this, at Meribah, this is where they did this. They come up, and it's the middle of the desert, and there's no water, and 2 million people and livestock, they need some water, right? And so they come to Moses, and here's what they say. Now, the pillar of cloud, pillar of fire, is like literally right there. They see it. But they look at Moses, and they say, did you bring us out here into the middle of nowhere so you could kill us? Come on, man. Life was good back in the slavery days of Egypt. At least we had food to eat, right? And so they go off, and they're just complaining. And they're blaming Moses. And instead, like, God's right there. And they're like, you're the one who brought us here, Moses. It's like, did you forget? Like, the Spirit of God led us. And Moses just doesn't know what to do with himself. He goes, God, these are your people. These are not my people. These are your people. Do you ever say that about your family? Like, Lord, these are your people. I don't know. Like, I'm linked in somehow, but these are your people, Lord. Like, these are not my people. But what am I going to do with your people, God? And he's just fit to be tied. And the Lord says, here's what I'm going to do. My presence is going to be over here by this rock. And I want you to speak to the rock. And I'm going to make water come out of it. And I'm going to get all this glory, Moses. And people are going to see I'm real. And I'm right there with them. And I haven't left them. And I haven't forsaken them. Right? And so Moses, like, he starts out really good. And then he goes. And then, but he makes this huge mistake. He gets really angry. Like, Moses was a hothead. Any hotheads in the room? Right? All right. Yeah, that's okay. Good. One person. That's me too. All right. And so Moses is there, like, and he just, like, he gets really upset. And instead of speaking to the rock, do you know what he does? He speaks to the people. And he's like, you bunch of sorry leatherneck. Like, he's just going off. You people never believe. And then do you know what he does? He makes it about him. And he says, what do you want me to do? You're asking me for water. What do you want me to do? Hit this rock and make water come out? Fine. Bam. And then he uses the staff of God to hit the rock. And nothing happens the first time. And then Moses has this moment where he could totally repent and be like, oh, God, I'm so sorry. You know, but he doesn't. He doubles down. Boom. And hits it again. And then the Lord does a miracle. Even through Moses' anger, boom, the rock opens up and water comes out for all the people. But it's called Meribah, this place of strife, not just because of the people, but because of Moses. Now look right here. Did you know that when we approach conflict, usually people have two ways of dealing with things? Like when you go through the trials of this life, when you go through hardships and pain and persecution, you usually fall in one of these two camps, right? Like, and so the first one is this. This is the one that the people had. It's like no matter how many times God's proven himself over and over in the past, like this is your mentality. You get in the middle of the hardship. It's like, God, you're going to have to come through on this. Like, you're going to have to show me. God, are you here or are you not? And if you don't answer this way, I don't even know if you're here, right? Like, that's the first camp. It doesn't matter how many times, like, that he's provided money for you, or he's provided protection for you, or he's provided confidence or grace or whatever it is. Like, in the middle of the hardship again, like, you come through and you get to this moment. It's like, are you even here? Do you see what's going on all around me? Like, that's the first camp, right? Now, here's the second one. This is the person that's totally aware of God's presence. And they say, hey, God, hold this. I got this. That's what Moses did. Like, he was totally aware of God's presence. He's like, God, do you see all these? I mean, these are your people right here. Like, and I'm leading them, but, like, what am I supposed to do with them? Well, do this. Okay, well, I'm going to go do that. And then, hey, you know what, God? I got a better idea. Instead of doing what you said, hold this. I got this. Right? I mean, this is what a lot of us do, right? It's we're totally aware of the presence of God, but hardship comes in our marriage. Well, you know what? I better fix this. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to dial up this, and I'm going to do this. And you know what? I need this list. You know what? The things are crazy with my kids right now. You know what they need? They need structure, by golly. You know, and we're going to get this. And so faster bedtimes and da-da-da-da. You know, like, and it's, I'm going to make the list and do this. And I got this. Don't you worry about it. I got this, right? I mean, we do this with relationships, with friendships, with health, right? So here's the plan. I got this, right? And this. In the middle of hardship, like, there's the two temptations. Like, you can be over here and in the wilderness. Are you even here, God? Or you can say, God, I know you're here. But hold it. I got this. And both of them have the same terrible consequences. Look at what happens. Look at what he says. Verse 10. Therefore, I was provoked with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart. They haven't known my what? Ways. See, here's what they were doing. Listen, I know this would never happen with Christians, right? But here's what they wanted. They wanted God to continually do stuff for them, but they didn't really care about knowing the heart of God. Like, they were interested in the works of God. Like, God, can you fix this? God, can you do this? God, can you change this? God, can you restore this? God, can you fix this? God, can you heal this? Right? But they weren't really interested in knowing God himself and knowing his ways. They were just interested in God's hand and his handiwork rather than his heart. And so he says, because of that, like, these two groups of people, this first group, it's like, are you even here? Like, seriously? Like, are you even here, God? And this other group is like, God, I know you're here, but don't you worry. I got this. Like, both of them have the same consequence. Look at what it says. Verse 11. So I swore in my wrath, they will not enter my, what? Rest. 40 years they're wandering around in the desert. Think about that. Now, I don't know if you've thought about this or not, but like these people on this side, God, are you even here? Like they continually did this. God, are you even here? Do you even see that we need food? Do you even see? Well, it's like, yeah, I gave you manna. Well, yeah, I gave you birds. Do you even see that we need water? Do you even see that we need this, right? Like all these times, like, God, are you even here, right? Like they just did this over and over, right? Do you know Moses did it once? Hey, God, I know you're here. But I got this. And you know what? The consequences were the same for both. One moment. I got this, God. Don't worry about it. And he had to wander the desert for 40 years. And he didn't get to go in the promised land. How sad is that? Now listen to me. Look what he says. The author of Hebrews says, you want to know what's even more sad than that? Look at this. Look at the next verse. Verse 12. Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. Look at what he says. This is so big. Don't miss this. He says, can you imagine these Jewish people? They were constantly around the presence of God. Like God's spirit was right there, the pillar of cloud, the pillar of fire. They continually woke up every morning seeing God's provision. Time after time, they saw God's protection. And then they were always, whenever times got tough, they said, are you even here, God? He says, how sad is that? And he says, it's also sad that to be in the middle of the presence of God and say, God, I know you're here, but I got this. Don't worry, I got it. He says, you know what's even more sad than that? People being around the presence of God and doing those things. People who have the very Spirit of God living inside of them, and they still do the same thing. He says, you're new covenant people. They just got to be close to the presence of God. You get the Spirit of God living inside of you. If you're a believer, the Holy Spirit of God lives in you. You constantly have access to his peace. You constantly have access to his presence. You constantly have access to all of his provision. He says, look at me, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of you. That's the power source that's there. And he says, but how much more sad is it that for those of us who have the presence of God in us, for us to say, are you even here? Do you even see what's going on in my family? Do you see what's going on with my work? God, are you even here? Or how much more sad for those that the Spirit of God is inside of us and we say, hey, you know, I know you're here to give me your infinite power because you're inside of me. And I know you are here to give me your infinite encouragement and your infinite peace, but I'm okay. I got this. How much more sad is that? Look at what he says. Verse 13. But you want to know the secret to how we don't wind up there? Listen, you want to know the secret to how in our marriages, no matter how tough things get, that we aren't saying, are you even here, God? Or, hold on, I got this, right? Do you want to know the secret of how to make sure that every believer doesn't wind up at that place that's so sad where we have the Spirit of God inside of us, but we still say, are you even here? Or, I got this. Here's the answer. Look at verse 13. Here's the answer of how you don't get there. Look at what it says. But exhort one another every Sunday. Is that what it says? Exhort, you know what exhort means? It's literally like It's one of the names that we use, one of the root words for the Holy Spirit. It's the one who comes alongside to walk with, to encourage, to teach, to help, to build up. He says, you need to do that at least once a week. And then if you do that once a week, you're going to be ready to face whatever hardship. And then when it comes in your life, you won't say, are you even here, God? Or, hold on, God, I got this. Is that what he says? Like what he says. I love this. This is crazy. But exhort one another. How often? Every day. Yeah. Every day. Right? This is every single day. Every day you're supposed to exhort one another. Every single day. This is your goal. This is your mission in life. This is how you're supposed to treat one another. Exhort one another every day as long as it's called today. Like they were in a season of suffering. And he says, as long as you're in that season of suffering, you better make sure you're encouraging one another every single day. And look what it says. So that none of you can be what? Hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we've come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the very end. Here's what he says. Like, I love this. He says, do you know you can be jacked up, and if you're on your own, you'll never know how jacked up you are. Did you know that? Like, that's why God gives you marriage, to show you how messed up you are. Right? It's like, so there can be this continual mirror in front of you saying, look at how selfish you are. Wow, you're so about yourself. Like, look at how you don't like to serve. Look at that. Wow, you need to be more like Jesus. You know what I mean? Like, that's what marriage is for. And parenthood is an additional mirror, right? It's like, woo, I'm getting it from all angles. That's like a, I don't like that angle, right? You know what I mean? But it's like, to show you how much like Jesus you're not, to help you become more like Jesus. But this is what he says. He says, anybody that's alone is going to be prime opportunity to be attacked. Right? What do they do in the animal kingdom? They make sure that they get the one that they're after alone. Right? And isolation creeps in. And guess what? You can rationalize anything. Because Satan starts to whisper these lies to you. It's not that big a deal. Nobody will ever know. It's all good. You know, God really must not love you. If you're going through all this, you know what? What God cares most about, look right here. This is one of my favorite ones. You know, God just really wants you to be happy. He would never want you to be miserable like this. You should just end it. Because his plan is for never for you to be unhappy like this. Right? He starts to whisper lies to people. And if they're on their own, what do you hear? All day, every day, messages from the enemy, 24/7. It's through every billboard that you see. It's this different culture, right, where he's saying, this is it, this is it, this is it. And you think that by coming in here and hearing like an okay message for 30 minutes once a week that you're going to be ready to stand and combat the millions of messages you get throughout the week? No, you're not. You're not going to be ready. Look at what he says. Look right here. Maybe I'll say it this way. Do you know the answer to make sure that there's not a single marriage among the people that name Jesus as Savior? That there's not a single one where people say, you know what? I just don't know if God is big enough to fix this. God, are you even here? Or, you know what? God, I got this, right? Do you know the solution for that? Look right here. It's you. You're the solution. It's not better preaching, although I'm sure that would be great. It's not like more programming. It's not hiring more pastoral staff. It's not if we learn X, Y, Z better. He says, it's you. You're the brother and sister in Christ, and your job every single day is to look for brothers and sisters who are suffering, and you're going to be the encouragement that builds them up and fights the lies of the enemy. It's you. You want to know the secret to making sure that believers, as they graduate high school and go off to college, don't abandon the faith in droves? It's you. You want to know how to make sure that the people who are going through struggles at work continue to hold on to hope when it feels like the rug is jerked out from under them? It's you. You. You're supposed to exhort one another every day as long as it's called today so that you can build one another up and be ready to stand. Listen, how many of you had a fireplace? Like a wood-burning fireplace. And I love wood-burning fireplace. Some of my greatest memories are at my grandparents growing up with a wood-burning fireplace. And do you guys know what this is? What is it? What is it? An air pumper is not the technical name for it. Come on. It's an air pumper, right? You know what? What is it? What's it called? A bellows, right, a bellows. Now, do you know what you do with this? This is, as a kid, like when I was your guys' age down there on the front row, this was my favorite things to do. Like, this was my favorite toy in my grandparents' house because you could go up and you could make funny sounds with it, and you could go up to people, like, right in their face and go like that, and then their hair would go, stop it, it's not funny, right? Like, and all, right? I love this little thing. It's great. And so here's what it would do. Like, I have these great memories of my granddad. His name was Papa Duck. And my grandma was Mama Duck, right? And they live like 8/10 of a mile from our house. And so I can remember every morning my granddad would get up and he would restart the fire from last night, right? And so their fire had been burning, you know, and there's like little live coals going. And so he'd crunch up a little newspaper and put it in there, some kindling, and put some more new wood on the fire. And then he'd get over there and he just... That's how he walked anyway. He was kind of hunched over like... All right, here we go down. Just little tiny man, tiny squeezes, right? And do you know what that thing would do? Like just this little small thing would take that little live coal, and it would fan into this huge flame, and it would be this roaring fire before the end of just a few minutes. I mean, it would be unbelievable. Some of my greatest memories, like if it would snow, we would walk that 8/10 of a mile over to my grandparents' house. And I remember Mama Duck, she would always have baked potatoes wrapped up in aluminum foil, and they would be cooking in the coals in the fireplace. And we'd get little hangers, and we'd roast wieners over the fireplace fire. And like if it fell in the ash, we'd give it to my brother. That was great. But you know what? Like there's something so small, like just this little, and it takes what's already there and then bursts it into flames. This is the idea that the author of Hebrews is talking about. He says, this is your goal for every conversation you have in your day. This is your goal for every interaction that you have with your family. This is your goal for every conversation with your spouse. And it's not the, right? Like it's, you know what I'm saying? Like there's times you want to go to your kids and you're supposed to, right? There's time for your coworkers. You just want to, right? And he says, this is you. Every single conversation, he says, here's your goal. Every person that you meet that's a believer in Jesus, look right here, don't miss this. It's that you exhort and encourage, you come alongside them in that moment, wherever they are, and you fan into flame what's already there. You just give them a little boost, just a little word of encouragement. Just a little thing to help encourage. You know what? God is enough. Can I tell you about what he's done in my marriage? Man, we thought all hope was lost. And man, God has transformed it. I promise you, there is light at the other end of the tunnel, and it's not a train. I mean, you're just like that, right? Like you, for the parent who has a prodigal that's going on, you know what? You keep praying for him. I had a friend of mine that they prayed, and man, they prayed for 10 years, and you know what? Their prodigal finally came home and woke up, and I know that's going to happen. Can we just pray for your prodigal right now? Like you just, right? Like with your finances or your job stuff, it's like, you know what? Like it's okay, so you lost your job. Okay, so you're all of this, whatever. Listen, do you know how many times God's provided for us? I know he's going to provide for you. And guess what? You get to a place where you can't pay your bills, I'll pay them. Like you're my brother. You're my sister. I can't pay them all, but like I'll pay one, right? And like just in the middle of that moment was, and you're fanning into flame the thing that's already there, but you're bursting it into something bigger. The author of Hebrews says that's your goal for every single conversation, for every single day. I'm not going to bed until I've, for somebody, because that's how you make sure people don't fall away. That's how you make sure that there's nobody that wakes up one day and says, is Jesus even worth it? Because every day you got somebody here. You get it? This is every single day. This is your job. This is your role in the big body of Christ. That for every believer, every conversation, you fan into flames so that there's never a person who gets to a place where they say, are you even here, God? Well, yeah, I know he's here because my friend just fanned the flame. So that there's not a single moment where a person goes, God, I know you're here, but I'm just going to do this on my own right now. It's like, no, because your friends won't let you. Because you're choosing to live in intentional community where the goal every day is, I'm going to fan your flame. You know, I can't tell you how many times this has been such a huge thing in my life. For some of you that don't have it, listen, you make the choice to create that community. Right? You might go, well, I don't have that with anybody. Then you be it. Like, you be that for somebody else, and then you'll have it. Like, but I can't tell you how many times, like, even this week when we're going through all this stuff with our niece and everything, like, I have a friend, he's out of the country, and he texts me, hey, what's going on with this? Just thought I pray. Like, he's on dream vacation, but he's worried about my niece, who he's never met, because he wants to fan the flame. Like, there's times where I've had a terrible day. Katie and I have gotten into something, and we're fine, but, like, it was just stressful, or the kids are really driving me insane with something. My kids never do that, but, like, I'm just saying theoretically, like, if they were to drive me insane, right, in that moment, like, and I'll get a text message from a brother or sister in Christ who says, I don't know what's going on with you right now, but I just felt like I was supposed to pray for you. The Holy Spirit brought you to my mind. Like, he woke me up in the middle of the night. It was 4 a.m., and I just thought, I got to pray for David right now. Do you know what that does for somebody? Fans the flame. Listen, he says, you want to know how you're not part of this camp who says, God, are you even here? You want to know how you don't make that critical error where you say, oh, you know what, God, I got this. I don't really need you on this. It's you surround yourself with people that will fan the flame, and you can do that for each other too. Listen, the last verse, we're going to skip to verse 19, then we're going to be done. Here's what it says, verse 19. It says, so we see that they were unable to enter the rest because of unbelief. Listen to me. Aren't you so glad that you live in the new covenant instead of the old covenant? Now, here's the deal. We never forfeit the promised land. Even if you act like that, like if you know Jesus, even if you act like this, you know what? Like, it's God, are you even here? Like, God says, he'll never leave you. He'll never forsake. You've surrendered your life to him. You're sealed, signed, sealed, delivered. You're his, right? Song lyrics. Anyway, but so here, but he says, listen, that's not, but even if you say, God, you stay over here. I got this. Like he says, I'm not going to leave you. You're still mine. I've chosen you. I've adopted you. You're mine. Heaven awaits you. Your promised land is coming. But do you know what believers forfeit? Look right here. When believers live this way and they say, God, are you even here? God, I got this. Do you know what we forfeit? We forfeit his promised peace. Like, I love that old song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, right? And it says, oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we don't carry everything to God in prayer, right? There's moments when you're, God, are you even here? God, hold this. I got this. There's moments when you do that. You know what you do? You forfeit the peace and the power of God. And he says, you want to make sure that doesn't happen for you? You want to make sure that doesn't happen for your friends? Every day. You fan into flame what's already there. Let's pray. This morning, I'm just going to ask you to make a commitment. That this week, you're going to fan into flame the faith of somebody that's already there. That you know they're going through a tough time. You're going to reach out to somebody every single day. You're going to live an intentional community. It's not enough just to be here. You're going to be a part of a community group. You're going to make this little community at work with other people who are believers. You're going to make this community of believers in your recreation stuff with your kids. You're going to connect with parents there every single day. You're going to see somebody, and your goal is not just to sell them the new product, and your goal is not just to get the newest dish on what's happening, or did you see that new TV thing? Like, that's not, that's all okay, but your goal is that every conversation, I'm going to fan the flame. I'm going to encourage and walk alongside them so that they see God is enough. He's big enough for whatever they're going through. Maybe you do that on Facebook every day this week. You find somebody that's having a rough day and you just send them a private message. It says you're praying for them. You're encouraging them that God's big enough. Maybe it's you wake up and you pray in the middle of the night. Maybe it's that you text somebody. Whatever it is, listen, God says you are the way to make sure that people don't end up in that place where they're saying, God, are you even there? Or God, I got this. It's you. Through your encouragement, you get to be the voice the Holy Spirit uses as his megaphone. So this week, would you encourage and walk alongside somebody who needs it? You may be in this house and you're saying, I'm the one who needs that. I need to know God's big enough. I've been saying, God, are you even there? I've been saying, God, I got this. Well, listen, today is a day where you're hearing the good news that Jesus is enough. And even what other people have meant for evil against you, God can take and work it out for good, even if there's no way it seems like that's going to work in your mind right now. But there's people that are here that are going to pray for you. I'm going to ask our elders and wives to come on up and just, if you're here and you're just going through a rough season or you have a friend or family member who is, and you just want somebody to pray over you and for them, then I'm going to ask you to come right now. But this week, you be the encourager. Lord, rule and reign over this time in Jesus' name.